Good morning. Let's get started this morning and celebrate that we serve a risen Savior. You can stand if you'd like.
Out of the darkness, risen beyond the grave, risen forever, holy Jesus, your name we praise. Risen out of the darkness, risen beyond the grave, risen forever, holy Jesus, your name we praise. We lift your name high, proclaim it day and night, shout it far and wide. Jesus, you are the way. Jesus, you gave us new life. Jesus, your name we praise. Jesus, you hold the power. Jesus, you are the way. Jesus, you gave us new life. Jesus, your name we praise. We lift your name high, proclaim it day and night. Shout it far and wide, for you are alive. We lift your name. Shout it far and wide, for you are alive. So tell me, who was born in Bethlehem?
Jesus.
Who healed the lame to walk again?
Jesus.
Who gave the blind their sight to see?
Jesus.
Who died to set the captive free?
Jesus.
Who paid the debt of sin for us? God's own righteousness,
Jesus.
Who lives in glory to this day,
Jesus.
Who is the life, the truth, the way, Jesus. We lift your name high, proclaim it day and night, shout it far and wide, for you are alive. We lift your name. Shout it far and wide, for you are alive. Risen out of the darkness, risen beyond the grave, risen forever, holy Jesus, your name we praise.
Amen. You guys can have a seat. Bob's going to come tell us what's going on. Let's just continue to lift up the Lord and sing to him this morning.
When my hope and strength is gone, you're the one who calls me on. You are the life, you are the fight that's in my soul. Oh, your resurrection power burns like fire in my heart. When waters rise, I lift my eyes up to your throne. We are more than conquerors. To sin or to shame, we are defiant in your name. You are the fire that cannot be tamed. You are the power in our veins, our Lord, our God, our conqueror. I will sing into the night. Christ is risen and on high. Greater is he living in me than in the world. No surrender, no surrender. over despair, you are the hope. And we are more than conquerors through Christ. You have overcome this world, this life. We will not bow to sin or to shame. We are defiant in your name. You are the fire that cannot be tamed. You are the power in our veins, our Lord, our God, our conqueror. Nothing is impossible. Every chain is breakable with you. We are victorious. You are stronger than our hearts. You are greater than the dark with you. We are victorious. You are stronger than our hearts. You are greater than the dark with you. We are victorious. You are stronger than our hearts. You are greater than the dark with you. We are victorious. We are more than conquerors through Christ. You have overcome this world, this life. We will not bow to sin or to shame. We are defiant in your name. You are the fire that cannot be tamed. You are the power in our veins, our Lord, our God, our conqueror. There is a truth older than the ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. And there is one born for our salvation, Jesus. There is a light that overwhelms the darkness. There is a kingdom that forever reigns. There is freedom from the chains that bind us. And Jesus, who walks on the waters, who speaks to the sea, who stands in the fire beside. Comforts in the night. There is a voice that calms the storm that rages. He is Jesus, Jesus, who walks on the water, who speaks to the sea, who stands in the fire beside me. My healing in Him. There is no one like you, Jesus. And there is no one like you, Jesus.
we look to you this morning. We put our trust in you. Lord, no matter what this world brings, no matter what difficulties, no matter what triumphs, Lord, we just give you praise and give you thanks. To you be all the glory, honor, power, and strength. Lord, we just bless you this morning. We just lift you up. We give you the credit for all that is and will come. Lord, we pray that we can be humble enough to stand before men and declare that you are God, and by your power everything happens, and that you've chosen to use us. Lord, we just thank you for this morning. Be with Pastor as he brings your truth once again this morning. May our hearts be open and your spirit translate for us that we can fully understand what you have for us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
We welcome back to our stage international illusionist Stephen Ryan.
Well, thanks. Pastor asked me to talk about faith. Some people use the word belief. And being an illusionist, do you believe that I can actually accurately predict, what somebody will choose in the future? Since you know I'm an illusionist, you're probably like, oh yeah, he can probably do that. But we're going to see what we can do here. For this, we're going to do a basic trick, pick a card, whatever. But you are all going to be in on it, except for one person. Michelle, would you like to help out? Wonderful. Come on up here. Let's give her a hand. She's going to be directing my show in September, so now she kind of gets the inside look on some things. Well, kind of the outside look, because you're going to be the real audience, and you're going to be in on it. So, yes, I do the trick, especially for you.
I love cards.
I have a bunch of cards here. You can see that they are all different. I'm going to make a prediction from one of these cards, and I'm not going to show it to you, but I'm going to show it to everybody else. So don't say it. Just keep it in your head. If you're way back there in the cheaper seats having a hard time to see, you can whisper it to each other. And I'm going to place it in this stand here. So everybody can keep an eye on it. Now I have a duplicate set of cards here. Michelle, would you point to any one of those cards? Just point to one. That one right there?
Uh-huh.
All right. I'm going to bring it to the top. Would you take it? Don't show anybody.
Okay.
Look at it and hug it so that nobody can see. Now, would you be amazed if the card I placed over here is the exact same card that you have in your hand?
I would
be amazed. So here we go. So who do you think has more faith at this point? You, who know, believe it or not, they know how it's done right now, who know how it's done, or Michelle, who doesn't know how it's done, but I'll let you answer that for yourself. So now the moment of truth. Michelle, was your card the five of clubs?
No.
Now how's your faith? No, really, it wasn't the five of clubs?
I wouldn't lie to you.
No, what? It's the nine of diamonds.
Is that what it is?
Now kind of analyze a little bit here. How's your faith? Michelle, would you go over there?
It's a nine of diamonds.
And see if it's...
Oh, my gosh!
The nine of diamonds. Thank you so much, Michelle. Let's give her a big hand. But looking at this illusion, you can see how faith... Sometimes faith seems easy. It's like, yeah, this is how things are and everything's going smooth. Sometimes you don't know how things are going to go, but you're kind of like, well, this is good. Sometimes you're like, faith gets a little hard. And sometimes faith seems downright impossible. And sometimes you get to the end, it's like, what just happened there? And you find out, maybe years down the road, maybe not until eternity, why it happened. Because God is not interested in the here and now. He's not just interested in what we want, but he's interested in the long game. And he is there for us no matter what happens. And that, my friends, is what I like to call faith. And now I hand it back to Pastor Dan.
While you're thinking about that, open with your Bibles, with me in your Bibles, to John chapter 6, which is on page 942. And that's not an illusion. It's right there. No, maybe not in your Bible. But anyway, John chapter 6 today. Do you know how he did that trick? He showed you the cards, right? I don't know. Beats me. But he talked about faith. Faith is certainly central in the Christian life, isn't it? It's a huge part of the Christian. It is the Christian life. Hebrews 11, verse 6 says, "And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe," it's a synonym for faith, "that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him." So faith is central in the Christian life. It starts off by being saved by faith. We are saved by faith, John 1, 12. "Yet to all who receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gives the right to become children of God." How do you become a child of God? By believing in him, by faith. But faith doesn't stop there. We're to live our lives by faith. Romans chapter 1, verse 17 says, "The righteous will live by faith." And so it's a day-by-day, moment-by-moment life of faith. We're working our way through the Gospel of John in a series that we've entitled Believe and Live, which comes straight from John's theme verse, John 20, verses 30 through 31, where it says, "Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book." Signs represent miracles, not illusions, but miracles. "But these are written that you may believe, may have faith that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." In fact, John uses the word believe 96, 98 times in the Gospel of John. 98 times. Do you think that's important to him? Important in our Christian lives? You bet it is. Now, 2 weeks ago, think back 2 weeks ago if you were here. What did we talk about 2 weeks ago? Last week was Mother's Day. That's why it was 2 weeks ago, okay? We talked about the only miracle that appears in all four of the Gospels, and that is the feeding of the 5,000, right? Remember that? Actually, probably about 10,000 people, because they only counted men for some reason. I don't know why. So he probably fed about 10,000 people when you include women and children. But it all began as a test of the disciples' faith. Do you remember that? You only get that from John's gospel, not from the other three, but John makes that very clear. In verse 5 of John 6, Jesus asked the disciples, Philip in particular, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" And then in verse 6, John adds his own little editorial comment. He says he asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. So how did the disciples do on this test of their faith? You remember? Most of them got a big fat F, right? They failed miserably. A couple of them, Philip and Andrew, we might give them a D at best. But after this test, Jesus then proceeded to demonstrate his compassion and his divine power by feeding these 5,000 people from just five little barley rolls and two tiny little sardine-like fish. And the disciples had 12 baskets of fish and chips left over. So, quite a miracle. Do you think it bolstered their faith? I'm sure it did. Do you think they actually caught on to this concept of faith? Do you think they're starting to trust Jesus? Well, today we're going to look at a follow-up test. They did so badly on the first test that Jesus gives them another chance, okay? He gives them a follow-up test. John chapter 6, verses 16 through 24. We'll just read verse 21 to start with. Okay, it says, when evening came, his disciples went down to the lake, where they got into a boat and set off across the lake for Capernaum, the lake being the Sea of Galilee. It's not actually a sea. I don't know why they call it a Sea of Galilee, because it's freshwater, but it's a lake. They call it Sea of Galilee. By now, though, it was dark, and Jesus had not yet joined them. A strong wind was blowing, and the waters grew rough. When they had rowed 3 or 3.5 miles, they saw Jesus approaching the boat, walking on the water. And they were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I. Don't be afraid." Then they were willing to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the shore where they were heading. So today we're going to talk about calming the storms. You ever have any storms in your life? Calming the storms. Jesus walking on the water. We all like a nice, gentle breeze, don't we? And sometimes life is a breeze, right? Not always, though. Because sometimes that breeze picks up a little speed and it turns into a storm. Perhaps even a hurricane. The truth is, we all go through storms at times in our life, don't we? For instance, maybe you're a young mother and you have been up all night with a sick child. And then after dropping your sick child off at grandma's house to take care of her because you can't take her to school, and then getting the other kids to school, you get to work almost an hour late. You have a very stressful day at work, and after work you have to pick up your kids and you have to taxi them to all sorts of activities after school, like soccer practice and dance lessons and piano lessons. So you're taxiing all your kids all over the place, and it gets so late you don't have time to fix any dinner, so you stop by McDonald's and you pick up some Big Macs and some chicken nuggets for dinner. You take them home, and when you get home you find out that the air conditioning is not working and it's 95 degrees in your house. Kind of a crummy day, huh? How do you handle a storm? Do you take it on yourself, or do you trust the Lord for help? Do you call on the Lord for help? Or maybe you've had a family vacation planned for a while, and it all comes unraveled at the last moment. Has that ever happened to you? Your son broke his leg just a week before the family vacation, and had to have emergency surgery to reset the bone and put some screws in the leg and so forth and so on. And you finally get him home from the hospital and you get a phone call from your parents about a death in the family in a different city than you were planning to go to, which means flying to that city instead of flying to where you're going to go for vacation. You have to go there for a funeral. And of course, you can't get your money back on the airline tickets you bought for vacation, right? How do you handle the unexpected storms? Do you handle them by yourself? Or do you ask the Lord for help? Or maybe you're just about to retire and the stock market crashes and you lose 40% of your retirement account, your IRA, in just 2 weeks. So much for retiring. You can't afford to retire now, right? And then on top of that, you have an automobile accident and your car is totaled and you have to buy a new car, and that takes a few weeks to find the car you want. And if that's not enough, you haven't been feeling too well and your doctor wants to run some tests to determine if it's cancer. How do you handle the hurricanes of life? Not just the storms, the hurricanes. Do you try to manage them and navigate through them yourself, or do you place your faith and your life in God's hands? We all run into storms from time to time. Well, this story of Jesus walking on the water and calming the storm for the disciples is another lesson in faith that teaches us, I believe, a lot about how to navigate the storms of life. So three truths that we're going to learn about navigating storms. The first truth is to remember that Jesus' purposes are fulfilled through storms. Jesus has a purpose in these storms. Verses 16 through 18, it says, when evening came, his disciples went down to the lake where they got into a boat and set off across the lake for Capernaum. By now it was dark and Jesus had not yet joined them. And a strong wind was blowing and the waters grew rough. See, after the miracle of feeding the 5,000, Jesus sent his disciples down to the lake, back to the boat, to get into the boat to send them back across the Sea of Galilee. Matthew puts it a little more vivid language here, spells it out a little bit clearer. Matthew 14, verse 22 says, immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. And after he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. That word made in that verse, where it says he made the disciples, literally means to compel them, to force them into the boat. In other words, Jesus persuaded his disciples to get into that boat and to go back across the lake without him in the boat. Now, these guys, some of these guys are professional fishermen. They're experts on the water. Peter and Andrew and James and John, they had spent all night on the Sea of Galilee many times fishing. And so when Jesus sent them out across the lake, they didn't even give it a second thought about going on the lake. They might have wondered why Jesus wasn't going with them, but it says he went up into the mountain to pray. Verse 18 then says that a strong wind was blowing and the water grew rough. In other words, that gentle breeze turned into a sudden raging storm. The Sea of Galilee was well known for sudden storms. See, the Sea of, little geography lesson might help you understand why. The Sea of Galilee lies almost 700 feet below sea level. It is the lowest freshwater lake on the planet. The Dead Sea is deeper, lower, about 1,100 feet, but that's not a lake, okay? That's not freshwater, that's salt water. So the Sea of Galilee sits in a deep rift, deep valley called the Rift Valley between the Mediterranean Sea to the west and the Arabian Desert on the east. And there are hills on both sides of the lake that rise to about 1,500 to 2,000 feet above sea level. That's 2,700 feet above the level of the lake. In fact, this city where they're at, Bethsaida, is in the Golan Heights, and so what we call now the Golan Heights, and so there are definitely some hills about 2,000 feet high. What happens then is that as the sun sets, the air begins to cool, and as the cool air from the west rushes down the slopes and hits the warmer water in the lake, it creates this perfect condition for sudden and violent storms, especially in the evening and night times. Now, I've been on oceans in storms, a little bit. Not hurricanes, of course, but storms, with swells 12 to 15 feet high. A couple of times, about 3 years ago, we were on a cruise, cruising down the Atlantic Ocean with my extended family, all my brothers and sisters. We all went on a cruise together. It was fun. But a storm came up while we were on the cruise that prevented us from docking in the one port that my wife and I particularly wanted to stop in and visit. And we couldn't go because there was a storm. So I did the best I could with it. You know, we got to spend an extra day on the ship, which I don't mind. That's okay. But so I went down to some lower levels thinking that I might go out and look at the storm. Well, when I got down, I think the third or fourth level, there's a deck down there. And so I went down there and no, you couldn't go on the deck because there was a storm. They had the doors all shut. And so we couldn't go out there. But I could see through the doors these swells. And they were huge swells, 12 to 15 foot swells. Now, I'm on a huge cruise ship. Do those 12 to 15 swells impact the cruise ship? Not very much. You know, a little rocking and rolling, you might occasionally hit a swell just wrong and you might kind of fall a little bit, but it doesn't really impact the cruise ship very much. But years earlier, we had a family reunion up in Washington, the other side of the family, and we decided to take a few of us, I think Joelle was on this trip, and we went over to Depot Bay in Oregon and chartered a fishing boat, took a charter fishing boat out onto the sea. And as we were out there, I was beginning to wonder, why did this guy even take us out there? Because there were, again, 10 to 12 foot swells. And I don't remember if it was the same one that you were on or not, but anyway, it affected this. This is a little bit more than a little rocking, okay, like a cruise ship. I mean, we were literally boom, boom, like this. And if you were up on one side, you were looking down on the other people at the end of the boat. If you were down on that side, you were literally looking up at them. It was pretty good swells. We were fishing with one hand holding the fishing rod and the other hand holding the side of the boat just to keep yourself from falling into the sea. It was pretty rough. And this boat that these fishermen are on in the Sea of Galilee, it's a small boat. This isn't a cruise ship, okay? And so they are rowing and working as hard as they can to get to the other side of the sea. Why would Jesus send them out in this? I think Jesus had a purpose in sending his disciples across the lake. Several purposes, in fact. In part, so they didn't get caught up in the popular movement to crown Jesus king. They didn't want that at all. Jesus didn't want that. In part also so that Jesus could get away and spend some time alone in the hills to pray. But I believe the primary reason was this is another test of their faith. Now, think about these disciples, okay? They had just witnessed an amazing miracle, the feeding of the 5,000 or 10,000, whichever you want to say. And they probably had these 12 baskets of leftovers in their boat with them, okay? So there's a reminder right there of the miracle that Jesus had performed. We don't know that for sure, but they probably did. And on top of all that, earlier in Jesus' ministry with his disciples, he had already, on one occasion, calmed the Sea of Galilee, a storm on the Sea of Galilee, already. This time, Jesus had been in the boat with the disciples. He was sleeping while they were rowing until they finally woke him up and asked him to help. And instead of picking up an oar, Jesus simply looked at the lake and said, "Peace, be still." And it was calm as could be. And they had witnessed that. So, you would think they'd have no problem with this, trusting Jesus in this case, right? But they're rowing as hard as they can. They're doing everything they can to handle this storm without trusting Jesus. They're navigating it by themselves. Sometimes you and I get caught up in storms, don't we, in our own lives. Sometimes they're storms of our own doing. Sometimes they're storms just from stormy circumstances in life. Sometimes there's storms that are caused simply because we are following Jesus and the world doesn't like us. But there's a purpose in all the storms. Romans verse 8, or chapter 8, verse 28, someone asked me just this weekend, what's that 828 in the cafe mean? Oh, that's from Romans 8, verse 28. This says, and we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. So whatever the storms are, God can use those storms to fulfill his purposes. Jesus' purposes are fulfilled through storms. For instance, God uses storms many times simply to build our character, to build Christ-like character, to knock off a few rough edges. You have any rough edges in your life? I do. And sometimes God has to knock off a few of those rough edges, and it's the storms that help do that. God also uses storms to build patience and perseverance and humility. God uses storms to test our faith and to develop our faith. I think that's what he's doing here with the disciples. Problem is that when storms hit, our normal inclination is to attempt to navigate the storms ourselves, right? Rather than trusting Jesus. But the first step to navigating storms is to trust Jesus, knowing that he has a purpose in every storm. He's accomplishing his purposes through the storms. We may not know what that purpose is at the time, but God is at work fulfilling his purposes. The second thing we learn about storms from this text is that Jesus' presence calms our fears in the midst of the storms. Jesus' presence calms our fears in the midst of the storms. 19 through 20, when they had rowed 3 or 3.5 miles, they saw Jesus approaching the boat, walking on the water, and they were terrified. Now, they'd made some progress, okay? Probably before the storm hit, but they're about 3 to 4 miles out to sea, and it had actually taken them about 9 hours to get that far. So they're working pretty hard, trying to get across the sea. The reason I say 9 hours, Mark's gospel tells us that Jesus came to them during the fourth watch of the night. Now, the night is divided into 4 3-hour watches, 6 to 9, 9 to midnight, and so forth and so on. And so this is sometime between 3 and 6 o'clock in the morning where Jesus comes walking to them on the lake. I can imagine that with the moon shining on the lake, Jesus is up on a hillside praying, and he's probably praying to his Father in heaven and keeping one eye on his disciples out in the lake, the moon probably shining so he can probably see them okay. And so when he saw that the disciples were having a little bit of a rough time and were getting afraid and were a little fearful, he finally came to their rescue, walking on the water. Now, some people try to explain away miracles. You ever heard that? People try to do that? Jesus just knew where all the rocks were, right? So he could walk on the water, or at least it looked like a walk on the water. That would be an illusion. But this is no illusion. This is a miracle. The language of the text and the distance from the shore both suggest, both indicate that Jesus is miraculously walking on the surface of the water. So what these disciples see here is nothing less than the Creator himself in control of nature. Now, I love what Mark describes this. Chapter 6, verse 39, Mark says, he went out to them on the lake, and he was about to pass by them. Now, why would Jesus about to pass by them? Is this a race? It almost sounds like that, you know? Jesus is going to beat them to the other side of the sea, just walking on the water, and they're rowing in a boat? No, it's not a race. I don't think that's why Mark says that. I think Jesus simply wants them to see him. His very presence should spur on their faith and alleviate their fears. One author puts it this way. It says, though he wished that the mere vision of himself should prove sufficient support and assurance to them. So just seeing Jesus should calm their fears. And that's what Jesus wanted. But instead, the sight of Jesus scared them. They thought he was a ghost. Mark's gospel again tells us that. And so they were afraid. Don't be hard on them, okay? Think about it. If you were on a boat and you saw someone walking on the water, would that calm you down? Probably not. You'd be scared too. You'd be thinking, what's going on here? Is that a ghost? Okay? So don't be too hard on the disciples. But Jesus quickly alleviated their fears by saying to them, it is I. Don't be afraid. It's I. Don't be afraid. Now, when Jesus says, it is I, in the Greek, that's ego eimi. Jesus is actually using the very name of God, I am. It's not just some common idiom that says, hey, it's me, guys. That's not what Jesus is saying here. But he says, Jesus is very intentional in his words. And so he says, I am. He uses the same name by which God revealed himself to Moses in the burning bush. And so literally standing where only God could stand on the surface of the water, he declares what only God could declare, I am. I am is simply a reference to the eternal Almighty God, Yahweh, the great I am, the one who provides all that we need. You could think of it this way, whatever we lack, whatever we fear, Jesus says, I am. Do you lack understanding and wisdom? Jesus says, I am omniscient. Do you need guidance? Do you need direction? Jesus says, I am your shepherd. I will guide you. Do you fear death? Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. Do you need strength to get through the storms? Jesus says, I am omnipotent, all-powerful. So Jesus says to the disciples, I am. Don't fear. Fear not. His very presence calms our fears. Now, Peter's fears are certainly subsided, okay? Okay, Jesus said, I am. Peter says, hey, me too, okay? Here we go. And he jumps out of the boat, right? Again, Matthew's gospel tells us that. You don't see that here in John's gospel, but according to Matthew's gospel, Peter said, okay, Lord, if that's really you, then can I come to you on the water? And the Lord said, sure, come on. And Peter jumped out and started walking on the water. Of course, as soon as he started, got his eyes off Jesus, started looking around at all the waves, he started sinking. Until Jesus finally reached out with his hand and rescued him. Again, don't be hard on Peter. We do the same thing, okay? When the storms come, what do we focus on? Do we focus on the Lord? Or do we focus on the waves around us? And when we focus on the waves, what happens? We start to sink. We start to go under. Keep your eyes on Jesus. His very presence should alleviate, should calm the fears in life. When Peter focused on the waves, fear gripped his heart. Same thing with us. When we focus on the waves, we too will become fearful. What fears do you wrestle with? Are you afraid of failure? Rejection? Fear of disease or death? Fear of losing your job or your home? Maybe it's fear of all the things going on in the world today, these current affairs in our world today. That can be kind of fearful if we focus on those. But we need to keep our eyes on Jesus rather than the waves around us, the storm, and his presence will calm your fears. Third, Jesus' power pulls us through the storms. Jesus' power will pull us through the storms. Verse 21, then they were willing to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the shore where they were heading. See, once the disciples found out this was Jesus walking on the water, well, they said, Lord, jump in. Help us out. They welcomed him into the boat. And when Jesus stepped into the boat, the moment he stepped into the boat, the storm immediately subsided. Not only did he calm the storm, but the text here says they immediately reached the shore where they were headed. Now, some suggest, take that wording and suggest that this is another miracle, a third miracle. The first two, he walked on water and he calmed the storm, and now he transported the boat immediately to shore. I'm not so sure that's exactly what it means here. Doesn't seem to fit the language of the other two gospels that talk about this. The other texts, in fact, say that when the storm ceased, the disciples began to worship Jesus. They recognized him for who he was, and they fell before him, and they began to worship him. The word immediately could also mean straightway or forthwith or maybe even quickly. What happens, I think, is sometimes you get so caught up in the moment that time just flies, doesn't it? I think that might be what happened here. The storm ceased. The disciples begin to worship the Lord, and they get so caught up in worship that they arrive on shore before they even know it. But what I want you to see here, let's not get too hung up on that, but what I want you to see here is that Jesus didn't calm the storm until the disciples invited him, welcomed him into their boat. He could have calmed the storm anytime, couldn't he? He could have calmed the storm from the mountain he was praying on. He could have said, no storm. Would have been nice and calm. He could have calmed the storm as soon as he said, it is I, or I am. But no, he waited until they invited him into their boat, welcomed him into their boat. Then the storm subsided. Once again, the same is true in our lives. Jesus can calm the storms in our lives anytime he chooses to. But he usually waits until we invite him into our boat, into our life, until we place our faith in him and trust him rather than trying to navigate through the storms all on our own power. You ever do that? I do all the time. But Jesus will calm the storm in our hearts and our souls only when we invite him in and welcome him in. Then we come to verses 22 through 24. Let's read it, and then I'll just kind of talk about it. It says, the next day, the crowd that had stayed on the opposite shore of the lake realized that only one boat had been there and that Jesus had not entered it with his disciples, but they had gone away alone. Then some boats from Tiberias landed near the place where the people had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. And once the crowd realized that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got into the boats and went to Capernaum in search of Jesus, where they, in fact, found him. So once the disciples, after Jesus fed the 5,000, he dismissed the crowd. You remember that from a couple weeks ago? And most of the crowd went home. But some of the crowd just kind of hung around and spent the night hoping to see Jesus again the next day. And the next morning, though, they couldn't find him. He wasn't anywhere. Now, they knew that the disciples had gone down to the boat and gotten in the boat and had left for the other side of the shore, but they also knew that Jesus didn't get in the boat. So where did Jesus go? Why isn't he there in the morning? And how did he get there? Well, while they're thinking and looking for Jesus, some other boats from Tiberias arrive. Doesn't tell us why, just kind of something he throws in there. We really don't know much about it. But after they couldn't find Jesus, some of the people that had stayed behind got in the boats, others walked, and they eventually all ended up in Capernaum in search of Jesus, and they found Jesus there, where he began to teach them. We'll look at that next week. But how did he get there? How did he get to Capernaum? And when did he arrive? Nobody saw him walking on the shoreline. Nobody saw him get into a boat. I think that this paragraph, while it's a transition to the next section in John's gospel, I think it also serves as a confirmation of how Jesus, that Jesus walked on the water and he calmed the storm. How did he get there? I think John simply includes this to confirm the miraculous trek across the lake. Jesus walked on the water. Jesus calmed the storm. Jesus did the miraculous. Jesus is deity. Jesus is God. You can trust him. You can believe him. That's the whole point of John's gospel. Believe. You can believe him because he is, in fact, God. And when they found Jesus in Capernaum, he proceeded to teach in the synagogue, and he has to come back next week, and we'll talk about the teaching. But what we see here is that no storm is too big for Jesus to handle. Now, we all go through storms. You happen to go through any storms right now? Anything going on in your life that you might call a storm, or is life a gentle breeze for you right now? I hope it's a breeze. But if it is a breeze, beware. There's a storm looming in the distance. It's coming. Because we can't avoid them. Whether they're storms of our own doing or simply the stormy circumstances of life, when you find yourself in the middle of a storm, remember some lessons that we've learned today. Remember that God is fulfilling his purposes in your life. And instead of trying to navigate the storm on your own power, invite Jesus into your boat, into your life. Trust him. He will calm your fears, and he will still the storms. So think about it for a minute. In your outlines, I just ask you a couple questions there in the conclusion. First of all, what storms are you experiencing in your life right now? Might be some financial storms. You know, with our economy right now, our uncertain economy, and stock market crashing, and rising costs, and unexpected expenses, there could be some financial storms. If not now, perhaps ahead. Maybe there are storms at work. Downsizing, layoffs, no work for you. Maybe some family storms, marriage issues, rebellious children. Maybe some relational storms, maybe some trouble with some friends or some coworkers or some neighbors. Health storms, sickness, disease, surgeries. They come, don't they? They're unexpected, but they come. Maybe some emotional storms. You're wrestling with discouragement right now, or despair, or depression. That can be very debilitating, certainly a storm. Or maybe just a terrible, horrible, no good, very bad day, kind of like Alexander. What storms are you experiencing in life right now? You don't have to navigate those storms yourself. Invite Jesus into your life, into your boat, and cast your cares on him, as Peter tells us. Let him calm the storms. Let him calm your fears. Just place your faith in him. Trust him. Rather than in yourself. Because we can't handle it. I can't handle it. I need Jesus' help. Second question I ask on the outline there is, what fears are you facing in life? Any fears? Fear of failure? Fear of rejection or criticism? Fear of that C word? What's the C word? COVID? Or cancer? couple of scary C words, huh? Fear of losing a parent or a spouse. Fear of the future. Retirement. Fear of death. What fears might you be wrestling with? Once again, place your faith in Jesus. His very presence in your heart and your life will calm the storms. So I would just ask you today, what storms or fears do you simply need to turn over to Jesus today and trust him? As Peter said, cast all your cares on him because he cares for you. Let's pray. Lord, some great lessons to learn from these stories, particularly this one, Lord, of how you calm the storms in life. Thank you, Lord, that you just walk into our lives, and Lord, as we invite you in, we can trust you, and we can just place our faith in you, and you will calm the storms, calm our hearts, our souls. Thank you, Father. Lord, I know that there are people here going through a lot of different issues right now, some sicknesses, some disease, Lord, some emotional things, some financial issues. Lord, I just pray today that perhaps they've been encouraged, Father, to simply place their faith in you, trust you completely, Lord. And I just pray that each one of us would, in fact, even if we're going through life easy right now, certainly there are storms ahead. So I just pray that each one of us will continue to place our faith in you and live by faith day by day, moment by moment. We pray this in Jesus' wonderful, matchless name. Amen.
Won't you just sing with us as we close?
To Jesus. our glory and our prize. We adore you, behold you, our Savior ever true. Oh Jesus, we turn our eyes to you. Oh, Jesus.